Good morning, everyone. Welcome to day four of OCFS's Anti-Trafficking Summit. My name is Christine Anderson, and I am the Anti-Trafficking and Runaway and Homeless Youth Coordinator here at OCFS. And with that, I am also the Program Manager for Safe Harbor New York. I'm thrilled to welcome you here for the fourth day. Thank you for being here and your continued participation. I do have a few quick housekeeping items for you. Remember that summit has been all week with a 10 a.m. session and a 1 p.m. session every day. So we have 1 p.m. this afternoon left and 10 a.m. tomorrow. If you did not get a Zoom link for either of those sessions and you would like it, please email one of us and let us know, and we will get that to you as soon as possible. If you encounter any IT issues with the presentations, you can send an email to info@welfareresearch.org. It is at the bottom of your screen, or it will be. And
sorry,
help will be sent your way. If you have an IT issue during the presentation, please type that issue into the chat box and we will get you help as best as we can. All of our presentations are being recorded and they will be posted in HSLC for future viewings should you need them. Materials from our presenters will be distributed along with a post-summit survey later next week, so be on the lookout for that. And I will type that in a reminder in the chat. The post-summit survey is super important, so please use that opportunity to respond, provide feedback for us about our event, and then we can incorporate it into future sessions. Certificates, they will be issued after summit by request only. So if you need one, I will type the email address to send an email to requesting the certificate into the chat. Please let us know when you send the email, your name, the sessions you attended, and what email address to get that certificate to. Lastly, but most importantly, unfortunately, all participants will be automatically muted during the presentation. Each of our presenters has about 45 minutes or so of contents, and then we will have an extra 15 minutes of question and answer. If you have a question during the presentation, feel free to type it in either the Q&A box, which is at the bottom of your screen. There's a little icon with word bubbles above it, or into the chat, and our presenters or I will get an answer for you as soon as we can. If we do not get to your question at any point today, we will have a transcript of those and we will get you an answer as soon as possible. With that, I would like to introduce our presenters for this morning, and I'm very excited that they are with us. They are two of our very own Safe Harbor partners, Diana Velez and Zoe Mahan from Fearless of Hudson Valley. Diana Velez is the Anti-Human Trafficking Project Coordinator at Fearless, and she has been with them since March of 2019. She is the Project Coordinator for the Safe Harbor Program within both Orange and Sullivan counties, and has been working alongside caseworkers to support survivors of trafficking and at-risk youth. Zoe has also been with Fearless since 2019 as the Education Manager. In her job, she oversees the agency's plans for strategic education and outreach to adult and youth populations throughout the community in Orange and Sullivan. And in addition to managing and coordinating requests for education, she is responsible for designing and delivering education and training programs on topics consistent with their agency's mission and purpose. I'm very excited they are here to share their wealth of knowledge with us. And with that said, I'm gonna turn it over to Diana and Zoe.
Thank you, Christine. We are so happy and excited to be here. So like Christine said, I'm Diana. I'm the Anti-Human Trafficking Project Coordinator with Fearless, and I'm also the Project Coordinator for the Orange and Sullivan County Safe Harbor Programs. And we have Zoe here.
Hi, I'm Zoe, and as I said, I am the Education Program Manager at Fearless, and my gender pronouns are she, her, and hers.
Thank you, Zoe. So now before we get started, I'm just going to share with you a little bit about Fearless and our services. So at Fearless, we provide services, comprehensive services for survivors of domestic violence, human trafficking, teen dating violence. Some of our services include residential and non-residential services. So we do have a shelter in a confidential location for survivors of interpersonal violence, as well as advocacy services and counseling services. If there's a survivor who is in need of advocacy services, let's say in court or even outside of court, or counseling services, we are able to connect our survivors to those type of services as well. We do a lot of community and education and outreach as well. We do have an education team, which Zoe is the education manager. with our education team, we're going to be talking a little bit more about that later on. But with our education team, we go into different places to provide education and awareness when it comes to human trafficking, domestic violence, teen dating violence, healthy relationships, consent. So we go to different schools, middle schools, high schools, within Sullivan and Orange County to provide workshops and trainings, both to staff and also to the youth as well. Within the local places in Orange and Sullivan, we also provide trainings for different professional agencies, including Department of Social Services, law enforcement, runaway youth shelters, and some more agencies that are also contracted by the Department of Family Services or by the Department of Social Services to provide preventive services to work. We also have a hotline that is available 24/7, and something that I want to make everybody aware of. Recently, we actually launched our web chat, something that we realized that was needed, especially during this pandemic, was that many times there might be a survivor who might be quarantining or might be staying home with an abuser, and they wouldn't necessarily be able to pick up the phone and speak with somebody on the hotline, right? And that's the reason why we decided to launch our web chat as well. So a survivor will be able to communicate with a trained advocate via the computer, via their cell phone. So the way to access our web chat is if you just go to fearlesshb.org and you click where it says chat now, you will be able to chat with a trained advocate Monday to Friday from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Again, I just wanted to share that resource because that's something that we recently launched during the pandemic, as a means to be able to provide services to those who wouldn't be able to reach us in person or via the telephone as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the work that I have been doing in both Safe Harbor in Orange and Sullivan County. So even though everything abruptly we had to stop and move into remote work, we'll still continue doing the same work. We continue working along with caseworkers to connect with the youth. If we receive a referral, something that we did was that we will create a joint meeting, either via phone conference or via Zoom, to be able to engage with the youth and provide those services. Something else as well that we continue was our trainings and presentations. I want to say probably since the beginning of the pandemic, probably like around between April to now, just alone when it comes to human trafficking training, I have done at least 15 trainings for professionals in youth. Something that I have noticed is that at the beginning, even professionals were a little bit more hesitant to participate during the trainings and during the presentations. Something that was completely different when it came to youth, something that surprised me, but it makes sense because youth are a little bit more comfortable with technology, right? So whenever we had those presentations for the youth, they were very actively participating, unmuting themselves, asking questions, writing questions in the chat. So that's something that was very surprising, but was something that was really good to be able to engage with them. Even if we were not able to come into their schools or their after-school programs, we were still able to provide that via Zoom or any other platform that we had available. So something else that we did as well was our Summer Youth Leadership Academy, which Zoe is going to talk a little bit more about that, and she's going to be getting into the type of stuff that you're looking for in regards to YouTube and Instagram and everything that we have been doing. So go ahead, Zoe.
Sure. So I'll start with our Summer Youth Leadership Academy. We every year we host our Leadership Academy for students in Orange and Sullivan County. And historically, our academy takes place over 5 days, and it's five full days from about 9 to 4 o'clock, and they come for all 5 days. And we realized that it was probably not going to be possible for us to do it in person. And then if we did do it in person, we would have been limited to 8 students and 2 educators in the room. And that just didn't feel like we were getting, we were going to be reaching the most students, and we were going to be as successful as we could. And we created a hybrid virtual in-person model for our Summer Youth Leadership Academy. We extended it to 4 weeks instead of 1 week, but students were only participating 3 days a week and only for a few hours. what we didn't want to do is just take the model of our academy and do it completely virtual and have students signing on for full days on 5 days a week. We knew that that was not going to be conducive for healthy learning. It's also the middle of the summer, and students aren't going to want to sit in front of their computer all day. And so we had students sign in with us twice a week for 3 hours on Zoom, and then they came in once a week for 3 hours for our office hours. And during office hours, we had more in-depth discussion. We did more hands-on activities. They were able to bond a little bit with other students. And so they still got that in-person component where they were getting to know the other students, but we were able to do our office hours in different sessions. And so we split the students up into four different groups, and they came into office hours in the same groups. And so they weren't exposed to other, to more than 8 students at a time. And it seemed to work really well. We had 25 students around Orange and Sullivan County participating. Students were really engaged. We set the expectation very early on that the students would show up to the academy and keep their cameras on for the duration of our Zoom meetings. They could participate by either taking themselves off mute or writing in the chat. And that's exactly what they did. You know, we asked them once and they followed that expectation from the beginning, which we were really excited about. And we had a lot of participation over the chat. Some of the feedback we got from students was that they actually would have been willing to participate more than just 3 days a week and would have preferred that it was 3 weeks than 4 weeks. That was something that we had designed in the beginning just to try to minimize days per week, but students said that they would have been willing to do more days a week. And so that's helpful for us if for some reason next year we have to do another hybrid model. They also really appreciated the in-person components. You know, some students reported that they felt really shy participating over Zoom because of the impersonal nature of Zoom. And so they just didn't feel like they could participate. And so then they were really participating in our in-person components. And so we got a lot of really good feedback around the model that we created. And we were excited. We also knew that going into Sila, our most common way that we kind of market and advertise and let people know that Sila is happening is going into schools. But we couldn't go into schools starting on March 16th. And so we had to get really creative about what we were going to do to let people know that the academy was still happening. And, you know, we're posting on Facebook, we're sending out our mailing list, but the emails kind of fall by the wayside. You scroll past things on Facebook. And so we tried to get things that were a little more engaging and a little more grabbing. So we actually created a commercial that I'm going to show you. We created two commercials, one with our education team and then another with our students from the year before. And I'm going to show you our commercial with our education team.
Hello everyone, my name is Cody. I'm a youth advocate here at Fearless Hudson Valley, and my gender pronouns are he, him, and his. I want to talk to you about the Summer Youth Leadership Academy. The academy is open to anyone in grades 9 through 12, and the goal of the week is to really inspire and empower young people to create lasting change within their communities. We talk about all the different root causes of domestic violence and strategize with youth how they can play a role in creating a society free of violence for all individuals. At the end of the week, students receive 30 hours of community service and a letter of recommendation. We feed them and provide lunch and snacks throughout the week and all the materials that someone might need. If you're interested in being a part of this Summer Youth Leadership Academy, please head to our website or our Facebook page, print out an application, and email or mail it back to us, and we will get you signed up. I want you to meet some of the other amazing individuals that you might see throughout the summer if you join us. So.
Hi everyone, my name is Danielle. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I'm one of the youth educators here at Fearless. I'm so excited to see all of you at Sila.
Hi everyone, my name is Zoe. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am the education manager here at Fearless, and I can't wait to meet you.
Hi everybody, I'm Diana. I'm the Anti-Human Trafficking Project Coordinator. My pronouns are she, hers, and hers, and I cannot wait to meet all of you this summer.
Hi there, my name's Renee. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I'm one of the youth educators here at Fearless, and I'm so excited to work with you this summer.
Hi everyone, my name's Alyssa. I'm the community educator here at Fearless. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I can't wait to see you at SILA.
Hi, I'm Katie. I'm a community educator here at Fearless, and I can't wait to meet and learn from all of you.
Hi everyone, my name is Sarita Green. I use the pronouns she, her, and hers, and I'm the associate director with Fearless Hudson Valley. Each summer, we offer SILA, and you make it great. We can't wait to see you there.
Hi everyone, I'm Mackenzie, the Advocacy and Education Director for Fearless. We hope you'll join us for the Summer Youth Leadership Academy.
All right. So that was one of our commercials that went up on our Facebook, our Instagram, our YouTube, and was also emailed out to our school mailing list. We were trying to introduce ourselves and give students a taste of what to expect at the academy, and this is who you're gonna meet and who you're gonna be with. And the other commercial that we had students from the 2019 Summer Leadership Academy giving just a little bit of their experience and what they liked, what they've learned, and like a recommendation for students to join. And so both of those went up on our social media, and they were pretty successful. We definitely had a lot of engagement on our social media, and they were shared a lot. And so really trying to get creative about our marketing, and it felt to me, our goal was 25 students, and we had 25 students. And so that was our Summer Youth Leadership Academy.
Just to give you a little sense as to like the participation as we were having the SILAS wall, when we had our human trafficking 101, and something that we did is that at the beginning we spoke a little bit about human trafficking 101, and then we did a screening of I Am Little Red as well, and it went so well to the point where like they were so active and they were asking so many questions that we had to do follow up for the following time that they met, because they had so many questions that it had to like the conversation had to continue on the following day as well, right, Zoe?
It's true. The students were very engaged. They had lots and lots of questions. We utilized a lot of breakout groups during SILA where we would do our workshop all together, and then we would break into smaller groups for activities. And the breakout group students really appreciated because it allowed them to like ask questions in a smaller group, and usually we were able to get our discussion done faster than if we had done it all together with 25 students and our education team. And so using the breakout groups was definitely helpful, especially for days that we were doing workshops that may have had like a sensitive discussion where students were maybe feeling emotional about the content that we had talked about that day. So the small groups were very helpful. And that also was a factor in our office hours, which is our in-person component, and that's when we had like more in-depth discussion and we had activities that they were doing, and so they were able to really process. And that was also some of the feedback that the students had given us, that part of what they appreciated of the office hours was, and the that the academy happened over 4 weeks instead of 1 week, was that they had a lot more time to reflect and process the information they were giving. And so they felt like it was very beneficial as opposed to going through 1 week very quickly. They felt like they had a lot of time to really think and process and reflect, which was positive. Yeah. So the other thing that our education team has been doing, you know, we have been going into schools and out into the community doing our regular workshops, but not nearly as often as we were when we were fully in person and when schools were fully open. And so we wanted to come up with ways that we could use our social media and we could use virtual platforms to get in touch with students and to continue getting our message out there. And one of the ways we thought we could do that was we created a series called Ship or Snip. It's a YouTube and social media series where our education team films ourselves having in-depth conversations and discussions about relationships that we're seeing in popular TV shows and movies. And so each episode, we pick a different TV show or a different movie, and we dissect the relationship that we're seeing. What things are healthy, what things might be unhealthy in this relationship. It's a really, really fun series. And it's been through several renovations. It's been through several changes. We started it in May, and we're still continuing it now. We started at first doing it every week. We wanted to do an episode every single week, and realized that that was not manageable. We didn't have the manpower to do a 30-minute episode every week, and so we transitioned to every other week. And it was, our videos are about 25 minutes long. They go up on our Facebook, our YouTube, and our Instagram, our IGTV. And so we did that all the way through the end of September. And from May to September, that felt like enough time for us to really evaluate what we were seeing. And so we ran some analytics throughout September of who was really engaging, what's been successful, what hasn't been successful, and really recognizing that we didn't have as much engagement in our episodes as we wanted. And we had a lot of questions about maybe why that was the case, maybe like really wondering why people weren't as engaged as we were kind of hoping they would be. And we thought there was a couple of different things. One, maybe nobody knows about it. You know, maybe our marketing is minimal and we need to boost up our marketing. And two, maybe our episodes are a little too long. We started talking to some youth and really surveying individuals about what they were watching on social media, and recognizing that youth and even adults, as they scroll through social media, they'll watch videos that are 5, maybe 10 minutes long, but don't often watch a full 30-minute thing on their phone, right? Like that's a whole episode of television. And so 30 minutes felt like a big ask if we're posting something on social media. And so we've recently gone through some changes of how do we, number one, boost our marketing, and number two, shorten our videos a little bit. But I do want to give you a taste of what Shipper Snips feels like. And so I'm just going to show 1 minute of an episode. So I have it all queued up. So this was our episode on the TV show Schitt's Creek, and we were talking about the characters David and Patrick, if you're familiar.
Expressions of boundaries and interest and nonverbal consent, almost. Like consent is something that is very explicit and specific, but there are ways to give consent without using our words, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we're seeing a lot of nonverbal cues here that they are both comfortable. We're seeing a lot of nonverbal things happening, right? Neither one of them explicitly says, like, can I kiss you? Yeah. We see if they had really like closed off body language, or if David, the second they pulled up to the motel, had like gotten out of the car, that would have been very clear messages that maybe he didn't want to kiss Pat.
So just a small taste of what an episode looks like. It's very strange to see my face on my computer twice, so that was enough. But really, it's just our educators having a discussion with each other, and we do throw in scenes from the shows into our videos. I didn't show enough for us to get to a scene, but we break up the discussion with some scenes or some pictures from the show. So they're a lot of fun. They're fun to film, they're fun to prep, and they go up. They were going up every other week, but now going into October, we're trying out something new, trying to see if it helps. So where we are creating TikTok style videos that are marketing our episode. And we're also going to be streaming our Shipper Snip episode live at the end of this month. We recognize that if you go onto Facebook Live, anyone who likes you gets a notification, hey, Fearless is going live, check it out. And are hoping that notification to all the people who like us on Facebook will be enough for them to at least sign on for some of our content on the episode. And we also have some really fun I don't have TikTok and I don't know how it works, but my educators do, and they've created some really wonderful marketing videos, and I have one of those queued up for you as well. We're trying to think about fun ways to market and get the word out that Shipper Snip was happening, and recognizing that if we were able to put out a video that had no sound but captions and it was 1 minute and was fun and interesting to watch, that people would definitely engage with it. And so this is what we came up with.
Something wakes you up at night, whispers in your ear. Somehow, someday, somehow, someday I'll find, somehow, someday I'll find my way back to you.
So that was our educator, Renee, having lots of fun in her office and getting very strange looks from her coworkers. So we released one of our TikTok style marketing videos yesterday, and that one will go up likely next week. So save the date, October 28th, Fearless will be going live for our first live episode of Shipper Snip. Typically, we record it on a Zoom meeting, and then I edit the video on like iMovie just on my laptop, and then we post it as a regular post on Facebook, but that's really easy to scroll past and miss. And so we're hoping that as we go live, it will be very, it'll at least give people the notification that we're going live, and people will join in. I love the feedback. Thank you. I'm glad that people are loving it. That was really the whole point of creating that in the first place, was to really just get people interested in the series. And so that's what we're trying to do. We know that it's like young and inviting, and so that's what we were hoping for. So I'm glad that that's our feedback so far. Really, the idea behind Shipper Snip was to take this idea of media analysis and really analyzing what our youth are watching, right? The idea, we've all been home since March, and we know that social media use is up, and TV, the amount we're watching TV has definitely increased. And so if we can take a second and connect with youth about the relationships that they're watching on TV or they're seeing on social media, and really critically analyze, is this healthy or is this unhealthy representation of what a relationship should look like? And so we actually have been, as we go into schools, doing either Teen Dating Violence 101 or Healthy Relationships workshops. We've been referring them also to our YouTube series and doing sort of mini Shipper Snip episodes during our workshops with students. And so we're still engaging in that media analysis question. We actually have an activity that we do during some of our healthy relationship workshops called Famous Pairs, where we give them relationships that they may be familiar with, famous relationships or from TV shows or movies, and we ask them to describe that relationship. And it's very intentionally objective, just describe this relationship, what comes to mind. And so we sort of took that activity and made it into a larger video series. Yeah, so that was my long-winded spiel about Shipper Snip. But October 28th at 7 p.m. will be our first live episode. So we're hoping that that's successful.
Something that is also very important to keep in mind is that when we do our presentations and we do provide trainings for professionals, for community members, parents, caregivers, guardians, and youth, that we always try to gear our presentation and what we're doing depending on the audience that we have, right? So if there has been instances where we do have youth who could be as young as in fifth grade, sixth grade, mm-hmm. seventh grade, right? So we'll always make sure that our presentation is geared towards their age and their understanding, right? Yeah. So like when we come to do presentations about healthy relationships and consent, when our educators go into the schools and even now remotely when we do those type of presentations, right, we'll pay attention to explain things and provide the presentation in a way that they will be able to understand the concept of consent, right? Because if you go and tell a somebody who is in sixth grade, they might not necessarily know the word consent, right? So like going into explaining to them exactly what that is in a way that they will be able to understand that. So that's something that we have been focusing on a lot as well. It's really important to pay attention to the type of audience that we have to make sure that the message that we want to give, it's coming across to them.
One thing that the education team has been doing for schools, some schools are very open to having us do like a live virtual workshop, either through Google Meet or Blackboard or Zoom. But then there are some schools where their classes meet asynchronously, and so that's either not an option or would be difficult or challenging. And so what we've been doing is recording our workshops as if it were like a pre-recorded webinar, so that our educators get together and go through the PowerPoint together on Zoom and record that. And then we send that to schools as like a pre-recorded webinar style workshop, and we usually send it along with a worksheet. And so we're really trying to be flexible with schools and with community members on what's possible for them and how we can continue to partner to get our information out there. If it's not like we would love to do live virtual workshops, we would love to do in-person, but that's just not an option right now. And so these pre-recorded webinar videos have been successful. The way that we've been sharing them, we went through a long process of how it could be most easily shared. And what we came to was it's easiest if we can upload our workshop video to YouTube as an unlisted link. And so if you go to our YouTube page, you won't see any of our workshops. But if I send you the link to it, then you can watch it. And so that's one way that we've been sharing that successfully without barriers. We tried to send it through like a Google Drive link, but there were various permission issues, especially with students who were using a school email and can only receive content from another school email. And so the easiest way we've been sharing videos is through an unlisted YouTube link. Yeah.
And it also, when providing this online videos, like giving on YouTube and on Instagram, it feels very important for us that there be follow-up, right? So we are also very careful as to the content and information that we put, especially when it comes to like our YouTube series and our Instagram. We always want to make sure to redirect them to reach out to us if they have any follow-up questions or if they would like to speak with an advocate one-on-one, right, to be able to answer those additional questions that they have. So yes, this work that we have been doing so far, working remotely and providing this prevention work remotely, it's something that we have adjusted and that we have come to be able to enjoy to do this preventive work online. But it feels very important that there's also follow-up and that they are also aware that they are able to reach out to us if they need additional support. And even when we were doing in-person presentations, right? If there was somebody who didn't feel comfortable asking a question in front of everybody, or like even when it comes to Zoom, right? If there is a jur or a professional or a member, a community member who does not feel comfortable asking a question in front of everybody, right? Like telling us to like stay behind for like 5 minutes or like sending us a message through the chat in privately, that's something that we always encourage as well, because we do understand that it's not always comfortable for somebody to ask for additional support in front of everybody as well. Mm-hmm. Let me see. Okay.
Any questions?
Somebody's
asking. Hi guys. This is Christine. Thank you so much. I first heard about SHIP or SNP or SNP or SHIP. I always say it wrong. back at a Safe Harbor quarterly meeting, and Diana can tell you I was like obsessed. I just think it is the coolest idea. And I think if we all take a minute and think about it, it's probably something we do without even thinking about doing it, right? I mean, and any of us can do it in any capacity that we want. So if you work at a residential facility and you're watching a movie with the kids or watching television with the kids at night, it's a great way to open a dialogue. You don't have to be a trained clinician. You don't have to be, you don't have some specialized training, think of things like, oh, you saw that scene. How did that make you feel? Like, if your partner treated you that way, how would you react? And many of us, I'm sure, are having these dialogues with the youth we serve anyway. And I think that's so wonderful. So when you do ship or snip, who would you say is the target audience, or does it vary?
I think it varies really depending on the episode and the relationship that we're doing. We would love if all, ideally, and our main target audience was high school age youth, and that's who we were initially targeting. But there are definitely some episodes that are either younger or maybe even older than that. So it definitely varies depending on the show and depending on the relationship, but we do try to make it as general as possible. And so we do know that there are some parents watching with youth. And so that's sort of that's like a dual demographic that we're hitting, where we're not only speaking to the youth, but we're helping the parents start those conversations with their youth. And we do know that that's happening as well. I did just put a link to our YouTube and our handle on Instagram into the chat.
That's awesome, because I know that was a question I had, is how can people watch? I know I've watched a few. How are the shows and movies chosen? Is youth voice incorporated? Do you get feedback from kids like, hey, a lot of us, I have a 15-year-old, so I'm somewhat hip to what is popular. Obviously, I'm nowhere near as hip as Renee is, because she's got some sweet moves. But, you know, I'm familiar. I know The Kissing Booth is a very popular Netflix movie for that age. So how are those chosen?
That's a great question. So we have a running list that anytime we think of a show that might be appropriate, or a movie that might be appropriate, we have it on our list. And so if we don't have any subscriber or youth voices, we can pick from our list. But we actually, not too long ago, we posted on our Facebook and on our Instagram asking people to vote for which show they wanted us to do next. And so on Facebook, we had like four graphics, and they voted by the reaction on Facebook. So either like a thumbs up or a heart or the other two, and I don't remember what the other two were. And so whichever reaction we got more of, that was the show that we did. We also put up a poll on our Instagram story, so people could vote through the poll on which show they wanted us to do next. And so we do have some voices from the community, which include youth voices. We also, every time we pitch it in a virtual workshop that we're doing with youth, we ask the youth what they'd like to see and what relationships they'd like us to talk about, what shows they're watching. And so we do have their voices that way. And sometimes people will comment on our videos and ask us to do something specific.
Can you give some examples? I'm such a fan, I could probably list off everything that's on there, but I won't do that. I don't want to steal your thunder. Can you give people some other examples of, I know you mentioned Schitt's Creek and The Kissing Booth is what's coming, maybe some previous ones that you've done?
Yeah, so our first ever episode was at the start of quarantine, and we covered Tiger King. So that was our first episode. And then we did an episode on Little Fires Everywhere, which was a Hulu show. I'm going to go to our YouTube channel and look, because I'm not going to remember. We covered Beauty and the Beast and Frozen 2. We covered Never Have I Ever, which was a show on, not a show, it was a movie on Netflix. And we also covered To All the Boys I've Loved Before. And we also covered Dead to Me on Netflix.
Great. I watched the Dead to Me one, so that's the
one. Thank you.
Yeah, they're great. There is a question in the Q&A. Let's see.
How do you get the? How do you get the youth you work with on?
How do you get the youth you work with on social media? So, I think I could talk a little bit about that. So, a lot of times when we do presentations and workshops, we'll always make sure to provide them any additional resources that we have available. Something that when it comes to the Safe Harbor program, something that I always do when meeting with somebody for the first time, or even if I'm meeting with them as a follow-up, I'll make sure to provide them with resources available in the community as well. And those resources also include our information to access our web chat, so like our website, fearlesshb.org, our hotline, and how to access our web chat. So I think having those conversations with them when we are safety planning with them, because you'd be surprised that safety planning and social media, it's something that usually comes in every conversation that we had, that we have with the youth, right? Because a lot of times the referral could be done for several things, right? Including that the youth, there might be some pictures, or there might be a video, or there might be something that is putting the youth at risk, right? So talking to them about social media safety. So the social media is something that they are already utilizing. So why not use this to expose them to something that is gonna help them safety plan for the future, right? So like redirecting them to like our website, redirecting them to our Facebook, or redirecting them to our Instagram account, right? So that way they will be able to get a little bit more information as to what's going on with our agency and what other resources we have available. Something that we have noticed, especially with our youth, is that a lot of times they are so aware of technology that they might not always feel comfortable picking up the hotline, picking up a phone and calling somebody on the hotline because they are so used to texting, right? Mm-hmm. Or connecting with somebody via social media. So I think that's something that that works, having that conversation with them directly. But go ahead, Zoe. What else do you think?
One thing I'm thinking of is that we've really utilized our youth from the Summer Youth Leadership Academy to get to other youth on social media. And so having the youth that attend our Summer Youth Leadership Academy follow us on Facebook or follow us on Instagram and then share different things. We ask them to share our like workshops or our content with their peers at school. And so utilizing youth that we're already connected to has been successful as a way to connecting to other youth that they associate with. Mm-hmm.
That's great. And I know you said that you ran some analytics, and this is something we talked about earlier in the week. You know, Kaylee had been using Facebook Live and she ran some analytics. Were the analytics you ran, were they ran through Instagram or was that through Facebook?
We ran the analytics on Facebook and YouTube, not on Instagram, only because I didn't know how.
That was going to be my next question, darn it.
No, so I have since learned, someone did tell me, I mean, it is possible, especially because we have a business account for Instagram. I didn't know how a month ago, but I do now. But so it is possible only on the phone, and ours is going to look different because it's a business account versus like a personal account, but we can run analytics. And so Instagram and Facebook have ways to tell you like what your most popular posts are, where your people who are engaging with your post are engaging with them, like what county or where they live, what time of day is most popular, what day of the week is most popular to post. And so that was good for us to see. We saw that on our Instagram, Wednesdays was the most popular and most engaging day. And so we moved our shipper snip posts from Fridays to Wednesdays. And so trying to boost engagement, we saw that most people were engaging either first thing in the morning or in the evening, and less so during like work or school hours. And so really trying to push out things that we really wanted to make sure people were seeing either in the evening or our first post of the day. So we did run at least the Facebook and YouTube analytics to guide the changes that we made.
So can you share exactly where do they have to go to get those analytics?
So if you go to Instagram and you're looking at your page, on the top right corner there's the three little bars, and it says insights, and it looks like a bar graph, and it says insights. And that's where your analytics will live. And it'll tell you how many various accounts on Instagram you've engaged with in the last, I have ours for the last 7 days, how many interactions you've had, if you've gained any followers, which posts and which stories were most popular. And you can click on various things to get more information about each of those insights.
That's great. We have another question in the Q&A, and I'll let you guys tackle that.
How do you count how many students you reach with pre-recorded webinars lessons?
That's a great question, and that was something that we were trying to tackle right from the beginning. And so what we do is, like I mentioned, we share our pre-recorded webinars through YouTube, and I can see on YouTube how many views we've had, but I can also break down how many views by the day. And so I know if I've shared that unlisted link with the school on Monday, I know that from Monday, any views from like Monday to Friday are likely that school. And so if I have 30 days from this Monday until tomorrow, I can attribute that to the school that I sent the link to on Monday.
That's great.
We also have had schools signing an agreement. What we didn't want to do is just send out a webinar and then have that pre-recorded webinar be a replacement for us coming in forever in the future. And so we have schools signing an agreement that they will only use the link and use the webinar from this date to this date and only for this purpose, okay. Meaning like only for this one class. And so our intention is when we are back in person, those videos will be taken down from YouTube so that we don't become replaceable with just our webinar videos, especially if eventually I stop monitoring the numbers. And so when we do go back in person into schools, those will be taken down so that we get back into school.
And awesome. I guess the reason for that as well, you know, it's because we want to make sure that there's also follow-up, right? That it's not just that we are providing a video and then there's no other follow-up, because it's very easy for somebody to just have the video and provide that, but then not have any information or resources available or who the student is able to reach out. And that's something that definitely feels very important, to make sure that if we are providing this information, that it's very critical and important that there's also follow-up so the youth is able to reach out to our hotline or our web chat or one of the national hotline numbers for right. follow-up and support.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The pre-recorded webinars, you know, I mean, they're a way for us to continue to engage, but they're not ideal because it removes us from the conversation, right? I would love to be there live with students to answer any questions they have. The biggest limitation with sending this webinar is that they don't usually get their questions answered. Right. I mean, we send it along with a worksheet to try to help with that. And I always tell the teachers, like, if students have any questions, email them to me and we will answer them as quickly as we possibly can. But we don't love being removed from the conversation in that way.
Right. And you have another question in the Q&A.
What is the youngest age that Fearless has worked with? We've worked with elementary students, and so third or fourth grade. We will work with anybody. We feel like especially conversations about consent or healthy friendships, like those conversations can be had from very young ages. We've shared on our social media before about how to start the conversation about consent with very young children from a young age. And so we really value having these conversations young. I would say it's not as common for us to go into an elementary school as it is middle or high school, but we absolutely have.
That's great. And I do just want to, go ahead, Diane, I'm sorry.
And they, when it comes to our younger youth, a resource that we utilize a lot, it's I Am Little Red, which I'm not sure if some of you may be familiar, but I Am Little Red is a 10-minute animated film that was created with the help of youth who were impacted by sex trafficking. So I Am Little Red is a resource that we have been using for our younger youth, anywhere from like 10 to 11 years old. And the feedback that we have from that is that this is able to show them what sex trafficking is and what tactics traffickers are using in a way that they are able to understand what's happening, right? Of course, we just don't screen the film. At the beginning, we'll make sure to like talk about what human trafficking is and then follow up with a discussion in a way that they will be able to understand the information that we provided, right? Something else that we have done is in the community, we have actually partnered with other agencies as well to bring community awareness where prior to COVID, we had community members, parents, and youth come together for a screening of I Am Little Red. And then after that, we separated and we broke into different groups where two of our staff took on the group with the parents to talk to them about safety planning and social media safety. And then myself and our youth advocate took on the group with the youth to be able to speak to them a little bit more as to what human trafficking is and the resources available and what can they do if they see something like this happening in the community or if something like that was happening to them. So that's something else that we have utilized with our younger kids as well.
Great. Great. I do just want to jump back to the Leadership Academy because I think it's so important. Something you guys mentioned, how the kids are so much more engaged. And I imagine that after being cooped up for months and months, any kind of other interpersonal reaction with people who don't live in their home was probably amazing no matter what. And you fed them. So that's food always works, right? Can you share with us, if you receive over 25 applications, how is it determined which youth are in the program?
Sure. So while 25 was our goal, it wasn't necessarily our cap. It was our goal. Okay. And it was our goal because that's how many faces we can see on a Zoom screen, and we didn't want to have to toggle back and forth between pages. I mean, we weren't going to cap it at 25. We had a higher capacity. So students do have to fill out an application for it. And really what we're looking for in the application is, do we think that the student really wants to join the academy, or is somebody like making them join this and they're not going to be participating? Or are they saying anything on their application that might be harmful? We talk a lot about oppression and anti-racism in our Summer Youth Leadership Academy. Do we think that they're going to be able to participate in that conversation in a safe way? And we didn't have any applicants that we rejected this year. Not everyone we accepted attended, but we did accept all of our applicants from this year.
Okay. And so you mentioned, go ahead, Diana.
Sorry,
I'm excited. I have a lot of questions.
About the question, there's a question on the Q&A. Oh, yeah. So Frosting was brought up. Was there any discussion held with the younger students about relationships with the opposite or same sex that would be considered appropriate? If so, how was that handled?
In our Summer Youth Leadership Academy or in SHIP or SNP, I'm wondering. We did a SHIP or SNP episode about Frozen 2. We talked about Kristoff and Anna in that episode. And so in our episode of SHIP or SNP, we didn't have discussions about same-sex couples. But we did have a conversation in SILA. We had a whole day where we focused on LGBTQ and allyship. And so we defined LGBTQ language and definitions. We talked about what that means and what that looks like. We talked about intersectionality between LGBTQ and other identities such as race or religion. And we talked about how to be an ally for an individual and what it means to be an active bystander. So the conversation was had in that sense. I'm hoping that answers that question.
Right. And just to kind of piggyback that, what my question was going to be, what are the topics covered? And because some of those are very sensitive topics that we know that kids can come to programs with beliefs that they were raised in their family or via their religion. Do parents sign off on, like, let's say a waiver, like, here's what we're going to talk about, just so you know? And can you tell us a few other, I know you mentioned, oh my goodness, racism and oppression and LGBTQ. Can you tell us maybe a couple of the other things that are covered?
Absolutely. So in our Summer Youth Leadership Academy, we talk about teen dating, violence, and healthy relationships, human trafficking, consent, victim blaming and rape culture, media analysis. We talk about LGBTQ and allyship, talk about oppression and anti-racism. We talk about what it means to be an active bystander and what it means to be an ally in general. And then we do a day on self-care because we know that we've talked about a lot of really heavy things. And so we talk about self-care and why that's important. Also, every student in our Summer Youth Leadership Academy creates a community action project where they are to identify an issue or a problem that they see either in their community or their school and come up with a plan to address that problem or issue that they're seeing. And so some students wanted to start a like teen dating violence awareness week in their school, and they came up with events that they wanted to host, or some students wanted to do an event that talked about human trafficking. They wanted to do an assembly at their school. One of the students wanted to create a creative art show at his school that was representative of teen dating violence and human human trafficking, and every student could create an art piece that was representative of what that experience was like. And so he was raising awareness in his school. And so every student does complete that. We also have, we require, because every student is in high school, we require a student signature, a parent signature on their application. And so on the application, we have all the topics that we're going to be talking about, not in depth, just as I've laid out the topics, just like that. But a parent does have to sign off that they are participating.
Okay. You know, because I can imagine, or I should just pose this as a question. How is it handled when a youth comes to the Leadership Academy or SILA? Or even any of your, you know, workshops, and comes with maybe a statement, or, you know, I hesitate to say belief because we don't really know, that kind of is counterintuitive to what we're trying to educate youth on.
Sure. I would say that happens. That happens all the time,
right?
For sure. I mean, like there are individuals who have different either beliefs or ideas or things that they believe. I'm going to say beliefs
right.
again.
Right.
We're not there to preach beliefs or values.
Right.
We're there strictly to educate. And so all we do is we engage in a conversation with that student. Like I said, our application is making sure that students can participate in a conversation safely,
right.
Not necessarily do you have the same beliefs and values
right.
as we do, because that's not an expectation that's realistic. It's just, can we have a conversation safely? If we are doing a presentation and a student says something that we feel like might make another student feel unsafe, we might stop the conversation and pull that student aside at a later time and have that conversation individually with that student, and so we're not having it publicly and making another student feel like they're kind of being put on the spot. So we're not there to challenge. We're strictly there
right.
to educate on things that we're there to educate on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Diana, anything else?
Yeah, and a lot of times also you'd be surprised that yes, even though we're the ones who are there to like bring this education and awareness, the same way that a student is probably bringing up their beliefs, it's the same way that maybe another student is going to come up and have a conversation with them, right? Or have a healthy discussion, right? Because even though they don't have the same beliefs, this person share what they believe in, but then this other person might come and share, okay, so this is X, Y, and Z, right? So a lot of times, yes, we're there, we're the ones providing the education and awareness, but a lot of times that conversation becomes very, very organic between the students, even while we're having the conversation. Yeah.
Yeah. And I love that, because I think in today's society, one of the things that I know many of us struggle with or witness is that people have opposing beliefs about a variety of topics. And the most important skill I think we all can learn is that it's okay for us to believe different things as long as we can talk about it in a safe way and it's constructive and we can respect each other's opinions. I think that's a skill that even many of us as adults could learn and hone. I just want to, we're going to wrap up in a minute. I'm just going to give like 3 or 4 more seconds. If anybody has any last minute questions, follow them on Instagram, follow their YouTube channel, tune in on October 28th. Renee will dance. I don't know, really know what to expect, but I know I'll be watching. I just think this concept is so wonderful. One of the things, as you all know, we've talked about all week is how important it is to listen to kids, hear what they're saying, meet them where they're at. Social media is where they're at right now. And so I think, we have a comment. I think in order to do violence prevention education, we do have to say not all beliefs are okay. That's very fair, absolutely. And you know, kids are on social media. So TikTok, Instagram, this is where they're at. You guys are surely on the cutting edge, and this is something we can all take back to our work in whatever capacity we're on or in, excuse me, and make it work for us. There is
one more question.
What time on the 28th? Look, you have, we're all going to be tuning in. You're going to be
blown. I love it. That's hard. Good. 7 p.m.
All right, 7 p.m. October 28th. Be there, be square. Watch The Kissing. The Kissing Booth is actually a really cute movie, too. I've seen both of them. And they love the way you are using social media, and so do I. I appreciate you both so, so much for being here. To all of you who participated, thank you so much. And, oh, I don't want to close out with stuff in. Oh, it just says thank you in the box. And we hope you will all turn in this afternoon. Thank you so much. Thanks, Zoe and Diana.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
See you on the 28th.
Yes. Thanks.